Thank you very much, Zakia, for inviting me over. That's the second chance that she gave me. 2 years ago, I had to talk about organic spintronics, but unfortunately, I could not. So Ifor Samuel took my place. That's a new type of physics in organic electronics in general. As you know, organic electronics came from batteries, doping. The Nobel Prize was given to the trio for doping organic polymers. But then we moved to nonlinear optics, organic light emitting diode, organic transistors, organic lasers, OPV. And recently, in 2004, the field moved to, well, the novelty in the field moved to organic spintronics. But I didn't want to confine myself to organic spintronics only, so I call my title Spin Effects in Organic Optoelectronic Devices in general, because some of you do that in any case. Okay, the outline of my talk will be introduction to organic spintronics in general, because people are not familiar with it, organic spin valves, and tunneling magnetoresistance and giant magnetoresistance. Then I moved to the bipolar spin valve that we achieved recently, spin organic light emitting diode that we can control the spin singlet and triplet in the device. Then I show you a way to control the intensity of devices by a hybrid organic inorganic spintronic device. And finally, if I have time, I'll go to enhancement of organic photovoltaic by spin 100 radicals. People are, where they know if that additives can improve organic photovoltaic, but not through spin 1/2. So that's a new thing. First of all, spintronics dictionary. Some of you may know, but some of you don't. So it's very general. The electron spin and hole spin are spin 1/2 charge carrying excitation. If they meet, then singlet exciton can be formed, but also triplet exciton, as you know. And I'll talk about spin relaxation time. It's a time during which the prepared spin sense stays unchanged. And spin injection is a property that carrier injection with preferred spin sense are injected in organic. Spin diffusion length is the distance spin carriers diffuse before spin flip occurs. And this LS, which is the diffusion length, can be very different from the drift diffusion. Spintronics, actually, it's around for 20 years and was a Nobel Prize in physics given 4 years ago to Fert and Grunwald. So why organic spintronics? The advantage of organic spintronics is that we have long spin relaxation time for electrons and holes. And the reason is that organic have weak spin orbit coupling. As you know, spin orbit coupling go by Z to the power of 4. So organic of carbon, oxygen, and so on is very low. Then also the hyperfine interaction is low because of the properties of the pi electron orbitals. And so that's good for long spin relaxation time. In addition, organic can produce light emission, and so they are not inert. They are not passive. If you put them in spin valves, they can emit light and change the light intensity and colors as you see. And the possibility of engineering all organic by putting organic ferromagnet. So those are the advantages that I think in organic. And let's start with a new possible device, which is a spin organic light emitting diode. If both electrons and holes are injected with spin up and down, everybody knows that the maximum quantum efficiency of an organic light-emitting polymers is 25%. So 25% is singlet and 75% triplet. And people devise some nice ways to put organic light-emitting diode either in phosphorescence or luminescence. But suppose that instead of the electrodes, regular electrodes like ITO and aluminum, I do the same thing with ferromagnet. So for ferromagnet, the injection electron hole depends on the magnetization of the electrodes. So for parallel magnetization, you see that the electron hole are injected with anti-parallel spins. And so this can be can give you 50% quantum efficiency for organic light emitting diodes that are based on singlet. However, if you have anti-parallel ferromagnetization, then the hole and electron will have parallel spins, and then either you will have zero electroluminescence or electroluminescence in a different color. And so by magnetic field, if I can change the magnetization of the electrode, I can go either from high electroluminescence to low electroluminescence, or from one electroluminescence with one color to another electroluminescence with another color by changing magnetic fields. So that's a nice device that not many thought about it, say 10 years ago and so. So, but however, how to achieve that? For the device, the prototype device to achieve it is a spin valve device. So spin valve device were invented 20 years ago, as I told you, and it consists of two ferromagnet and some non-ferromagnet in between. So non-magnetic in between and two ferromagnet. And so it turns out that if you have parallel magnetization, then the resistance is different than if you have anti-parallel magnetization. So if you are able to change the orientation of the magnetization from parallel to anti-parallel, you can have control over the resistance of the device. So this was invented, as I told you, and the giant magnetoresistance, this is called magnetoresistance, up to 300, but you will see there is a session 8813 in SPIE on spintronics, and you see even today, a talk that probably will have 800 or 700 magnetoresistance. What kind of ferromagnet we need to inject carriers? These are two electronic structure of well-known ferromagnet. One is nickel, the other one is LSMO. You see in nickel that the Fermi level actually at the Fermi level, there is spin up and spin down, and so nickel can inject carrier from the Fermi level with preference of one spin over the other, but it's not 100%. On the other hand, LSMO, which is also a ferromagnet, can inject carriers with polarization, spin polarization of close to 100%. The reason is that the two electrons, spin up and spin down, are so much apart that the Fermi level actually is situated in one of the bands where there is only one type of spins. And so, by definition, almost, if LSMO can inject carriers at low temperature, then the carriers must be polarized, spin polarized. Except, of course, that the diffusion, spin diffusion lengths in organic or inorganic is a problem later on, you see. Okay, so how can we change the electron magnetization direction? If the coercive field of one ferromagnet electrode is different than another ferromagnet electrode, then by sweeping the magnetic field, this is MOC, by the way, which is magnetic optical carrier effect, you can see that you switch one ferromagnet, and then at higher magnetic field, you can switch the other ferromagnet. So you can switch the magnetization between anti-parallel magnetization to parallel magnetization, and therefore you can control the spin injection of electrons and holes. These are the vertical spin valves that we do in our group. The bottom electron is LSMO because of 100 spin polarization. The top electrode can be cobalt, nickel, or iron. There is high spin polarization, and the spacer can be anything from polymer to small molecule, or to C60. All we need is differential coercivity to do organic spin valve, and we need high Curie temperature to do it at room temperature. This is in 2004, that's a paper that started organic spintronics with spin valves. There was another paper before that by Italiani group, but it was not a spin valve effect. And so at low temperature, we got 40% giant magnetoresistance, and you can see how the resistance changes for parallel to anti-parallel according to the coercivity of the two ferromagnets. But at that time, we measure the diffusion, spin diffusion, by changing the thickness of the device, and we came up with a spin diffusion of about 45 nanometer. You say that that's the length at which the spin sands are preserved. But if you think about it, it's very small. But on the other hand, organic devices are thin also, like 100 nanometers or thinner. And so 45 nanometer with ALQ3 is not bad at all. Of course, if you can get rid of the aluminum, then the molecule will be only without any heavy metal, then the spin diffusion length probably will be larger. Then we did some bias voltage dependent, and we saw that the effect goes away at high bias. So the problem is, okay, if you want to do that in organic light emitting diode and the effect goes away, how would you do that? In a moment, I'll tell you how. And another difficulty was temperature dependence. At that time, we found that the effect goes away at high temperature, and at room temperature, we have only about 1%. So that's, and it's very different from the magnetization of LSMO. Of course, if you take a ferromagnet other than LSMO with Curie temperature larger than 300 K, you probably will have a larger degree. But you see, nobody understands really why the giant magnetoresistance goes away, because the figure of merit, which is delta over R, goes with the polarization degree of the ferromagnet and also the spin diffusion length. So we don't know really whether this effect, the temperature dependent, is due to the ferromagnet or due to the organic diffusion length temperature dependence. Okay, so the first thing that I want to tell you about is the bipolar spin valve. Until now, I told you about single or homopolar spin valve, and this is also used for inorganic semiconductors or inorganic in general. But we have the possibility of bipolar spin valves. Both electrons and holes are injected simultaneously into the device. This appeared last year. So in this case, we have the device structure is the following. We have LSMO, ferromagnet, then the organic layer. The organic layer, we found out that if you put deuterated material, it's better than hydrogenated because the hyperfine interaction is smaller. So diffusion length is longer. This is the diffusion length of deuterated, and this is the diffusion length of hydrogenated. You can see it's much longer. And for LSMO, LSMO is an injector of holes. If you want the ferromagnet to inject electrons, I mean, you have to go to gadolinium. But gadolinium is it's tough to deposit, as you know. So we went through another avenue. Instead of just aluminum or calcium, we put lithium fluoride in between. And so those of you that know organic light emitting diode, they know that if you put lithium fluoride, then the electrode, well, effectively, you move the work function in such a way that you can inject electrons rather than holes. So the cobalt now injects electrons, and on the other side, the LSMO injects holes. When you do that, we found, well, this is IV characteristic and electroluminescence V characteristic, as usual. And this is a definition of magneto-electroluminescence. we found that indeed we can change the intensity of the electroluminescence by flipping the magnetization of the electrode from parallel to anti-parallel. And pay attention that the intensity decreases in the anti-parallel configuration. As I told you, anti-parallel configuration, you inject electron and hold that are with spin triplet, I mean spin parallel. More of those, a control experiment that we did, we changed the isotope in between the ferromagnet electrodes from deuterated DOPPV to C13 DOPPV, where every other carbon is C13. And by this, you increase the hyperfine interaction. Increasing the hyperfine interaction will decrease the spin diffusion lengths. And this is what we saw. In deuterated DOPPV, we saw, say, 1%, or here, 0.5%. In C60, we saw 0.2%. The same device, the same thickness and everything. For this spin organic light emitting diode, the voltage dependent is flat. It's not like before that there's a steep decrease in the voltage. And the reason for that we now enter into a regime that the inorganic spintronics do not pay attention to that, the regime of spin charge, I mean for charge density, that you have electron and hole together. And those people do not pay attention to those. Under this condition, you might have a voltage dependent that's different than homopolar device. Thickness dependence. We measure the device a different thickness, and we found out that the spin diffusion length, or the effective spin diffusion length in this device is 25 nanometer. Temperature dependence, for our surprise, the temperature dependence was very different than homopolar device, and it follows the temperature dependent of the LSMO. And so it's very different than a regular homopolar device. Homopolar device, you can see how the voltage dependence of the magnetoresistance goes down, but here the voltage dependence stops at some point and does not follow the steep decrease, and therefore we can inject electrons and holes and still get a magnetoelectroluminescence. And the reason for that we are in the regime of space charge limited current, which is very different regime in homopolar device. There was a summary of the spin organic light emitting diode. We have two components of magnetoelectroluminescence. One is non-hysteregic positive, the other one is for LSMO. And the magnetoelectroluminescence that we achieve so far at low temperature, it's about 1%, but it's a beginning. And it's very different activity or properties than homopolar device. And this points out to the importance of space charge limited current regime in spintronics. So now the question is, okay, this is low temperature, this is 1%. What are you talking about in technology? SPIE is all about technology. Well, 80% technology. So how can we boost it to room temperature and to, say, 80% control over electroluminescence? And this is the second part of my talk. Room temperature, spin OLED in hybrid, organic, inorganic device. And it was published a month ago in Applied Physics Letter. So the idea is the following. If you look at inorganic devices, you can see that they can go up to 600% easily with very large magnetic field. And this is Stuart Parkin. He will give a talk today, this afternoon at 4 o'clock in the session that I told you about. And it's an immense field. This is from IBM, of course. And they use it for all kinds of reading and writing and so on. So how to achieve it? Room temperature. Conventional organic spin valve cannot do it right now because we have only, as I told you, 1% at room temperature. Bipolar organic spin valve that I told you before, we have 1% magnetoelectroluminescence at low temperature. So now the trick is to put inorganic device together with organic device on the same chip. This is a magnetic tunnel junction that we received from our collaborators from IBM, Stuart Parkin et al. And this is a regular magnetotunnel junction. I show you, I'll show you it's 300 to 400%, and in a series to an organic light emitting diode that can emit red, green, and blue. So now, if you can put them together, so is the inorganic spin valve, you can see, has, say, 75% change in current and the magnetic field, and is very sharp and beautiful. But the resistance changes between 2.7 kilo ohm to very low kilo ohm, and delta R, changing resistance, is 2 kilo ohm. The device, the total device, is an inorganic magnetotunnel junction and organic light emitting diode. The organic light emitting diode under electroluminescence condition has about 120 kilo ohm resistance. How can you, by magnetic field, change the resistance of the whole device so that the electroluminescence will change by a lot? It's impossible. So you, if you put them in series and you make the calculation, then you can get 1.6% change in resistance if you put them in series. However, we got 8.8%, and so why? It turns out that there is an amplification in hybrid organic light emitting diode to get, that goes like that. If you want to keep the voltage constant and you to do your right calculation, you can see that the change in current is not only delta R over R1 plus R2, but you have another term, which is the derivative of R versus I. And this term is very large in organic devices under condition of space charge limited current. Actually, you can see here, if the current goes like voltage to power of n, then this term is proportional to 1 minus 1 over n. And so now delta I over I, rather than being delta R over R1 plus R2, is delta R1 over R1 plus R2 over n, if you like. And so this explains the 8.8% increase rather than 1%. But let's look at the electroluminescence coming from the device. We can do now devices that are red, green, and blue with this trick. And the electroluminescence can be, as you can see the table, the changes can be up to 80%, say, for a red device, magnetocurrent up to 34% at room temperature. You can get down to the blue, and you can also control the intensity in the blue organic light emitting diode by magnetic, external magnetic field. So voila, this is it. It's not great, but it's it's a beginning of controlling the electroluminescence intensity by external magnetic field. Why is it good for? What is it good for? Why should you control the intensity of organic light emitting diode by magnetic field? Well, first of all, this is not the last thing that we can do. As I told you, we can also control the color. You will see later. And second, now you can actually put the organic light emitting diode and the tunneling magnetoresistance device far apart. You can play with magnetic field on the tunneling magnetojunction, and by doing that, you can control the current and the electroluminescence of a device which is far away. Maybe some technology will need it. So the summary, we got giant room temperature magnetoresistance and magneto-electroluminescence up to 81%. And okay, we patented and so on, but we are looking for a technology using this type of device. The last part of my talk is not related with organic light emitting diode, but it's related with organic photovoltaic. And nowadays, there is a lot of, this is hot subject, spin effects in organic photovoltaic. People realize that not only there is charge generation from exciton, but the charge transfer, as I will tell you in a moment, has a spin triplet and spin singlet configuration, and then interact with singlet and triplet in the donor and acceptors. Okay, so organic photovoltaic solar cell, everybody knows in this audience at least, is the donor acceptor are together, they form blend, you excite the material, electron hole are generated somehow. If they are 80%, you are lucky. but usually it's not 80%. And then they move to the different electrodes and produce photovoltaic. Now, the model that now it's, goes on is the following, one of the models. You have exciton generation, then diffusion to the interface between donor and acceptor. At the interface, you see a charge transfer exciton, and somehow this charge transfer exciton separates into electron and hole. Now, this takes time. This time for diffusion, IFO will tell you it's about 10 picoseconds or so in donor-acceptor blends. But then, the how long does it take for the charge transfer to ionize? Sometimes longer enough that you can influence it, either by magnetic field or by spin additives, spin one-half additives. So this is what we thought, possible effect of spin one-half radical on organic blend. Suppose that you have now charge transfer exciton at the interface in the singlet configuration, because this is the first configuration that comes into in play after photogeneration. If you somehow can have spin one-half radical that influence either the electron and hole or all the spins, then you can transform it into triplet. I'm not saying that triplet charge transfer is good for organic photovoltaic. I'm saying the triplet charge transfer can be different. I don't know if it will increase it or decrease it. We didn't know at the beginning, but has different reactions. So you can play with this reaction and see if it increases or decreases. So what we did is the following. We use spin one-half radical galvinoxyl. You have here the molecular structure of it. We mix it together with, well, at that time, P3HT with PCBM. Now we have other devices with different polymer, donor-acceptor polymer. And to our surprise, the quantum efficiency, the PCE increases by about 10%. The current increases, photocurrent. Of course, the voltage remains the same. So we had an increase of about 10% in power conversion efficiency. Now, we do all kinds of magnetic field effect, and we see that magneto-photocurrent actually goes together with the increase of current, so it's not an artifact. It has some physical meaning that if you ask me, I'll tell you about it. Okay, so we did it in other blends that were available at that time, regiorandom, or a different percentage of donor and acceptor, and in all cases, we saw a large increase in photocurrent and PCE. Not all acceptors that are radicals are, can control the photocurrent. You need to have some kind of resonance between the radical, spin one-half, and either the donor and acceptor in the blend. If you don't have this kind of resonance, then there is no interaction. No interaction is possible, and you don't have the effect. On the contrary, most radicals that we checked actually decrease the photocurrent because they increase disorder and the mobility decreases. And so you need resonance, and so you need to find the right radical for the right acceptors. Now we do with the same thing with PCB. With different polymers, donor acceptors, and we saw an increase of about 20% from 7.5 to 8.5 quantum PCE. Conclusion, the status of organic spintronics at 2013. We have devices with two ferromagnet electrodes. Those devices are called spin valve, organic spin valve, and they show that there is a spin injection into organic. The record of those devices is 300%. And this was done in the laboratory of Fert, Dr. Fert, the Nobel Prize laureate in France. These devices show low field spin valve related effect. We know what contribute to a spin relaxation time in organic, mostly hyperfine interaction. You can play and tune the hyperfine player interaction by an isotope effect. We have achieved recently a spin OLED. It's small, it's 1%. However, it tells you that there is a lot to do in this field. And if you like technology, we achieve room temperature giant magnetoelectroluminescence by putting in hybrid organic inorganic. And so the spin effects in organic photovoltaic, I think, is the next challenge in organic spintronics. Thank you for your attention. My collaborators in this talk or in this work is Feng Liu and Misha Reich from University of Utah, postdoc Tone Goyen that now is University of Georgia in Dalisan. I have two graduate students, one of them moved to North Carolina in this project. And the other university, my friend Ethan Ehren from the Technion, Jing Shi from Riverside, our supplier of LSMO, Li from China, and two industries, Sergei Li from Plutonics, and Darin Laird, and finally from IBM, Maiden, the group of Stuart Parking.